If you want to pump your body and expand your mind, there's only one place to go. Mind Pump. Mind Pump. With your hosts, Sal DiStefano, Adam Schaefer, and Justin Andrews.
Yo, in this episode of Mind Pump.
It's because we talked about rap.
Yes, it is, dude. Yeah,
that's
right.
Racist.
Yeah, man. Yeah,
like,
yeah.
That's racist right
no,
there.
No, it's not. For the first 46 minutes, we do our current events introductory conversation. We talk about the weekend and the fights we all had and the makeup
and
sex
the makeup
we all had.
Part.
So ooh, weird. Yeah. All of us did that this weekend.
Yeah.
Isn't that interesting?
I don't know. We're all sharing vibes.
We're the same, yeah. Dude. We talked about this.
We talk about the documentary on Netflix called Rapture about the state of rap. I'm going to watch that so I can be up to date. I mentioned ButcherBox and actually how their steaks, their grass-fed and grass-finished
superior
steaks were better than the Whole Foods ones. And by the way, we got you guys a massive hookup. Massive. This is exclusive for Mind Pump. If you go to butcherbox.com/mindpump, you'll get free bacon, 2 ribeyes, $10 off, and free shipping on your first order.
Yummy.
This is the best quality meat. We talk about the dangers of selfies. Believe it or not, selfies killed more people last year than sharks.
That's right. I'll stop flushing my wife's when you stop taking selfies.
Yeah. Thank you, Adam. We talk about the future predictions from the first Earth Day that were just totally dead wrong, and how the government loves to prevent people from helping the homeless. They don't like competition. They want to be the only
you
ones.
You stop doing it. Only
right.
Us.
We also mentioned Organifi in this episode. We talked about the turmeric again. Now Adam's using it for inflammation. He's loving it. We are sponsored by Organifi. If you go to OrganifiShop.com, enter the code MindPump, you will get an exclusive discount. The first question that we answered was, can we talk about the benefits of using drop sets and when to use them? So drop sets are where you lift weight for a particular amount of reps, and then you immediately shift to a lighter weight and continue the set, and you do this 2 or 3 times to do an entire set, well, otherwise known as a drop set. The next question was, this was a personal one. This person wanted to know how I talk to my kids about my divorce. What were some of the things I talked to them, and what about the transition of moving out? Very difficult time. Definitely think there are better ways to handle it and worse ways to handle it, and I talk about that in this part of the episode. Then we get a very important, serious question. Do we fold or crumple our toilet paper before we wipe?
Yeah.
It's a question Adam picked there.
That
just
one.
Want to put that out there. And then
take care
that
of
one
our,
threw us for a loop.
Hooking our girls up
yeah.
there.
Yeah. And then the final question was, we have an asteroid coming to Earth. The impact is imminent. Do we want to be vaporized immediately, or do we want to survive with the other 10% of the people on Earth? And if we do, would we go to a safe haven, and how well could we survive? I think we all pretty much agreed.
Yeah. We're fucked.
We
don't want to eat cockroaches.
Yeah, we'd be dead.
Yeah.
We'd absolutely be dead.
Forget about it.
Also, look, summer is almost here. This is your time to get a six-pack. I'm talking about the six-pack on your midsection.
A beer.
Not a six-pack of alcohol.
Oh.
We have a program called the No BS Six-Pack Formula. It's a workout program just for your abs. We're giving it away for free this entire month if you enroll in any MAPS bundle. Bundles are where we take more than one MAPS program and we combine them together and discount them by 20 to 30% off. Our most popular bundle is the Super Bundle. That's several MAPS programs strung together to construct a year of exercise programming, all planned out for you. Exercise videos, blueprints, everything. You can find all these things, all these programs, and the bundles, and the free No BS six-pack formula at mindpumpmedia.com.
T-shirt time!
Who gets a shirt, Doug? How many people?
We had 17 reviews.
Hey.
And we're giving out 5 shirts. So the winners are That's So Joe, A. Carson 4, Bale 1522, Guitar Addict 1997, and Arctic Breeze 10.
Yeah. That's a throwback.
All of you are winners. Send the name I just read to iTunes at mindpumpmedia.com. Send your shirt size, your shipping address, and we'll get that right out to you.
So fresh and so clean.
So we were all sharing stories over the weekend. It sounds like everybody had great sex weekends.
Yeah, man.
Let me take you on a sexcapade.
Yeah, yeah.
Everyone did. Although I fucked up, dude, Katrina's gonna be so mad I share this right now. So we kind of got into it a little bit this weekend because I've been feeling good lately, man.
I've been feeling really good as far as my libido and shit. It's been, we haven't talked about it.
Bro, your hormones are coming back.
Man, I'm pretty excited right now. This is, and I don't want to jinx
Hello,
it.
Hello, Morningwood.
I don't want to jinx it, but it's, I'm finally feeling back to my normal self. I'm motivated to work out. Like, I'm excited. Like, I know when I'm back to me is because I don't know if you guys do this, but like when I'm in the groove and I'm like training and dieting and doing well and stuff like that with my fitness, like I'm thinking about my workout the next day.
Oh, yeah.
Like, I'm like really like excited about
it. It's
fun. Like, yeah, no, it is. It's really, but it wasn't like that for the last couple months. So it's finally got back into that, and I'm starting to see the libido change and everything like that, and just been feeling really good, man. Had incredible sex this weekend, and afterwards we're kind of laying there, and she's just like, you know, it was mind blowing, right? And she's just like, man, what
are you? She's like, she's paralyzed.
Yeah, she's laying there, and she's like,
alive?
what do you think that was right there? And I'm like, it's funny. I kind of chuckled. I'm like, I'm unpacking it right now, right? I'm like, in my mind, I was thinking about like, damn, what got into me right today. And I thought about everything that happened. So I'm sitting there, and she's like waiting for me to respond. And I'm really like thinking about it, and I totally led with the wrong thing completely. Like, so I take full I take full responsibility.
What did you do?
Well, because I led with this literally this sentence. I said, "Well, the crazy part is it's not you." Right,
no,
right.
No, dude.
Right, but the honest part about me was that's not what I meant. Was like, it's not that she's not beautiful, and my point was, and what I said after that was,
well, it's
that
you're literally saying it wasn't you when it was bad.
Exactly. Right. So what I exactly. But what I should have known better was to say that to my girl during this time of the month, and that knowing that that was coming, right? Yeah. And knowing that this is probably going to trigger her to be like, you fucking asshole, right?
Like, wait, hear me out.
Yeah. And so I'm like, it wasn't you, you know? Yeah. So I was
there's
fucking
more
idiot.
To the story.
It's not you. Yeah, it's not you, baby. Yeah. I could have been horny no matter what.
But what I was trying to say to her was, you know, we're 7 years deep into this relationship, and I'm like, I'm just as physically attracted to you as I was day one. And the sex is just as amazing since day one. In fact, we have moments like this where it's like, oh my God, that was the best sex of our life type of deal. I said, so that still is happening. And so my love for you is not changing. It hasn't changed. If anything, it's only grown stronger. But what just happened right now, if I'm being completely honest, was it really wasn't about you. It's really about myself. And it's really, you know, if you think about what happened. So earlier in that day, that just happened to be the same day. So this was Friday or Thursday. I can't remember what day. But it was a day when we were all in here and we were talking about revenue and the numbers and the projections and, you know, Mind Pump's killing it and doing well. And, you know, we're finally going to start being able to really pay ourselves. And like, it's just a really good time for that. And we had just, Taylor was reviewing all the sponsors. We did so well for our sponsors. We're doing better than any other podcast is for all the sponsors that we have. So all this great, like, financial news. My work, I just had an incredible workout. I'm starting to kind of feel myself a little bit. I'm filling my shirts out again. So I'm feeling fucking great, right? And I told her how much of that. It's crazy that these things are so important to me that I have all of it in place because I know that I'm loving myself. And if I'm truly loving myself, it allows me to love you at full capacity.
Mm-hmm.
And I know that even when I'm not loving myself, I still love you and we're still a great partner, still a great team. But I know that when I take care of myself and I take care of all the things that are important to me, that it allows me to love you on another level that you deserve.
Well, you back up a little bit, you know, I know how you feel about your girl and you consider her a very special, the most special person in your life. So if you have someone like that in your life that you consider that special, you wouldn't want to give them something that you didn't think was awesome. So if you don't think you're awesome, if you don't love yourself, you're not taking care of yourself, you can't possibly love that person to your full capacity. Because if you don't think you're good, well, why am I going to give this piece of shit to this awesome, incredible person? And this is how people fuck themselves up.
Right.
And that's where it makes sense when people say, you have to love yourself first before you can love someone else. I used to think that was bullshit. Like, what do you mean by that? It's stupid. It doesn't make any sense.
Yeah.
No, it makes perfect sense because if you really care about somebody and you think of yourself as somebody who's worthless or garbage or lazy or unattractive or whatever that's bad, how could you possibly give yourself fully to someone? In fact, you would probably... it would be terrible. It wouldn't be good.
It's so, so important. And I see this in relationships all the time now.
Oh, yeah. It's super common. It took me long time. You don't know this when you're young. I don't know very many people who know this until they're like in their late 30s, 40s, even. It just takes a long time to figure it out. Some people never figure it out.
Oh, right.
But once you figure it out, it's magic, because then all your relationships with all the people you care about, including your family, your kids, you know, you can't be great to your kids if you don't think that you're worthy of for them, right? Yeah. How can I be a good father if I don't think I'm a great person?
Well, it's
to
just
my
a
kids?
Direct reflection. You yep. know, like yep. I always look at it that way. Like the state and the temperament of the house is such a reflection on what I'm bringing, you know, in every day, and like what kind of energy I'm waking up with, what kind of energy I'm coming home with, what kind of things I'm contributing towards, you know, and like thinking, you know, outside of myself, but also like, you know, making sure like internally I'm presenting myself as like, you know, excited and motivated and, you know, trying to, you know, better everybody along with me and kind of bring everybody up. Yeah. But yeah, it's like, it's funny because same thing, great weekend, awesome weekend. But that happened as a result of something previous to that, right? We had a date, you know, earlier in the week, and I was so excited because we hadn't had a date in like a couple months. Like this is bad. Like I hadn't actually scheduled it out or made it happen, like a deliberate date where it's like me and my wife and this is just our time, you know, and like we're gonna go do something specifically to us. And so we went out and it was like we're catching up and we're trying to do this because we had like a block of maybe like 4 hours, right? Because like my parents watch the kids, and so it's like, yeah, we get this time and we're catching up and we're trying to, you know, it's like we're trying to rush all this momentum and mm-hmm. trying to make things happen. And of course my end, I'm like, yeah, you know, like I got this motivation at the end, you know.
Let's get to the good stuff.
You know, just totally,
I know how your brain works,
totally,
dude.
Fuck it up, you know, like God, my stupid male brain, you know, like I just would make a comment because I, you know, I like to have fun and you know, make jokes and stuff. And I just made a joke that just didn't
like a sexual.
Get, yeah. Sexual
so she's
reference.
She's trying to get all like connect and let's talk to
well,
each
she's
other.
Like, yeah,
and you're like,
exactly.
Show me your boobies.
Yeah, exactly. Like, almost on that level. I felt like
you
such
asshole.
A dick, dude. And I was like,
derailed the whole thing. Or
yes.
What?
Yes. It just totally just blew up.
And
in
it
my
turns
face.
Into a fight, right?
Yeah. It turned into a fight.
We never get these 4 hours.
I was like, cause she made a reference that I thought was like, I thought she was joking and like trying to be like, you know, like reference her body about something. And so I made a joke and, you know, she was being serious and like trying to like, you know, tie it into like something else. So we got home and big old fight, like big old ordeal. And I'm like, ah, this is not how I wanted this night to go. She's like, me either. Like we were so frustrated. And then I had to wait the whole week. And then I didn't think, you know, I was like, I don't know when we're going to get another date. I was like, oh, well, you know, we'll figure it out. Like I was already planning, like trying to, you know, get her flowers and do all this stuff like on outside the scenes just to like, you know, I don't know, show her that I'm trying to work on something and like, you know, make up for it. And thankfully she got a call from work over the weekend, was like, oh my God, I'm not working. And my parents had already told me they were going to take the kids from me. Sometimes they'll do that when I'm by myself, you know, over the weekend, and they took them overnight. And I was like, oh my God, we have all night. And so we went out, we took our time, we went to this restaurant, we watched all the crazies at the beach through this place at Aquarius, which is amazing. There was live music, and then, you know, I took her after that to go play pool, and she gets all this anxiety around like doing stuff, but I was just like leading the whole thing. I'm like, we're doing this, we're doing that. And she was just like, oh yeah, like she was totally stoked that I was like taking her through all the old steps we used to do. And yeah, and then there was the drive home, which fun stuff happened on the drive.
That's
so
awesome.
I'm gonna say.
That's so awesome.
When you push your girl to a limit, like when it gets to the heated moment where you guys are fighting or angry and stuff like that, is there a sign that you know, like, oh fuck, this is not gonna go really well? Like
yeah,
for me,
a
like
turning point,
like
yeah.
I get quiet. Like that's what like I'll just. She's like, oh, you're gonna just get silent on me because mm-hmm. I get so frustrated inside that I can't articulate my point well enough for her to get it. That I'm like, I'm done. Mm-hmm. Done having this conversation. No. And then I'm like, and then I'll just get completely quiet. And then she's just constantly in my ear, right? And I'm just like, I'm not engaging in this right now.
Yeah, we kind of go back and forth, and then we both get silent because we know, like, okay, if I say anything more, like, this is going to take this much longer to make up, you know, down right. the road. It's like we have that sort of level now where we just divide.
See, see, Jessica and I are we're so similar in so many different ways, and a lot of times that's awesome that we're very, very similar, but sometimes it's a bad combination, and we're both very sensitive, so we can get our feelings hurt, and then we're both like we need to express and communicate, and so if she feels like I'm not understanding her, she'll keep going, and if I feel the same way, I'll keep going, and it can escalate and escalate and escalate. And then, of course, the situation by which, you know, I met Jessica was right after my divorce. And so I'm already hypersensitive to fighting. And in particular, if I feel like somebody is acting like a jerk, if I feel like you're being kind of mean to me for no reason, if I start to perceive that, then I'll jump the gun. And I'm very, very defensive because I, like, the last 10 years of my marriage was a lot like that, right? So we'll be going somewhere. And if I feel like she's being anything other than, you know, normal or whatever, then I start to like get on top of it, and it's like it just turns into, we had a blowout on Friday. It was a huge blowout fight on Friday, and then it led into a great weekend though. Then after that, we had a great weekend. We hung out, lots of sex, had a good time, and it's hilarious. When you back up and try to break it down and you just see the breakdowns in communication, you're like, God, it's so hard when you're in the moment, and when you're feeling emotional and you're feeling emotion, it makes it almost impossible. And I also have a very difficult time with like anger that's expressed. So like any kind of raising in your voice, anything like that, which can make it very difficult to someone who's expressive. Mm. And I'm just hypersensitive to it. Like, raise your voice, I'm not going to talk anymore. And then that just takes it to a whole nother level type of deal.
So what was it that triggered it? I mean, what set it off for you?
You know, it's
I mean, I know I led with the wrong sentence. Yeah, that was for sure. If I could go back and do it all over again, I would have started with all the I love you stuff and how amazing you are and how great a relationship is, and then what's going on with me.
I guess I could go all the way back, you know, and think like, okay, what was the thing that caused it? But she was she was very energetic and getting a little hyper, and I was feeling like...
What do you mean? She's little, like, she's just running around the house, like all of a sudden she's jumping on the couches
just
and stuff like that?
No, just like lots of ideas, lots of whatever, but it can also come across as like you're maybe feeling irritable or something like that, which I may perceive it that way. It might not even be the case, but I just perceive it that way.
Like a little stir crazy?
Well, maybe, right? And so then my reactions start to reflect that. And so we were driving to Santana Row, and she was telling me how to drive, like, hit your brakes, go over here, do that.
Oh my God, does cause fights.
Yes. This is a male, I think it's a male thing.
Yes.
I think this is just something we don't.
We can't handle that.
No. And so I'm like, you know, I told her.
As much as a man like me, like you, need to be sensitive to a woman the week before her period, a woman needs to be sensitive to a man when a man's driving.
Oh, yeah.
If I go the wrong way, I meant to fucking go the wrong way.
Yeah. So we're driving.
That's part of the plan.
I knew that.
So we're driving and she's doing this, like, oh, hit your brakes, oh, go over here, go over there, whatever. And so I told her, I'm like, listen, I'm like, can you, you know, while we're driving, can you not tell me like what to do, what to drive? And so her response to me was, well, yeah, I'll do that if you can drive better. Like, oh, right? So,
and you know what? You know that's a soft spot for you because you know you're terrible at directions too. You know what I'm saying?
So it's a little jab. And it wasn't exactly like that. She was saying something
like a hard nipple twist.
She's like,
right there.
She's like, don't hit your brakes at the last minute. If you can stop doing that, then I won't say this thing. And so I'm like, oh, you know, so I'm frustrated with it. So we went back and forth a little bit, kind of let it go, had dinner. Everything was kind of okay. On the way back to the car, I'm like,
do you want to drive?
Yeah, I'm like, you drive. She's like, what? Why? What do you want me to drive? I'm like, I don't want to drive. And really what's happening is I knew how I was feeling, and I knew if she said anything about how I drive, it would make me want
to. This is the way to diffuse it, right?
That's what I think.
That's what you thought.
But the reality is that was the worst.
So now you're fuming in the passenger seat.
Yeah, no, it's the worst because now she feels like I'm bringing it up again.
Right. Or she feels like now you're gonna start to pay attention to how she's driving.
Like, that was water over the bridge.
Yeah. And now she's like, well, why are you know? So, yeah. So
or
then,
over.
So then she does that.
There's a new one.
It's a new one.
Fuck.
Yeah.
So she gets irritated. Like, why are you bringing this up? I thought we settled this. Like, you said you would do this and I would do that. And I'm like, so then she raises her voice a little bit because she's getting, you know, upset too. So then I replied and I'm like, I said something like, here we go again or something like that, right? Which is the worst possible thing to say to anybody, especially your girlfriend or wife, when they're starting to get angry, because then it sounds like what do you mean? Here we go. What do you mean? You know, so just turned to this big ass fucking stupid blowout, you know, for nothing.
Man.
But it was good. We made up, you know, made up afterwards. But, it, you know, I gotta hand it to her, you know, she didn't enter into an easy situation with me. I came out of a 15 year marriage. So that alone, I'm probably going to be more, and it's hard to say because I'm in myself, right? It's hard to observe when you're in yourself and reacting. But for sure, right, if you end a long relationship like that, especially with kids, you're probably going to be hyper vigilant. You would assume, right? So I'm probably hyper vigilant in that particular case, in a lot of different types of cases. Then on top of it, she went from being alone to dating someone who has kids, and now she basically has kids also. And so it's just all these different challenges. So I got to hand it to her. She handles things exceptionally well, and sometimes it's difficult. But anyway, hilarious, man.
everybody made it through.
It was a good time.
Yeah. Hey, you know what? I wanted to bring something up to you guys, and it's been we talked about this like, I don't know. We got into a little debate over it maybe about 100 episodes ago when we talked about rap. Mm. And you guys were giving me shit about like, new rap, and it's this. Just,
well, but I've been doing some homework,
right? Didn't you just you just watch Rapture?
Watched Rapture.
What is that? Is that a documentary?
Yeah, it's on Netflix.
Oh, I want to watch
that. It's a series. Yeah, they kind of go through.
I'll write it down.
New rappers and I think the next one was Nas that I was watching, but the first one I was watching was with Logic, and I just started getting into it and was like, wow, man, I was very. I don't know. I guess I was just very impressed and hadn't really dove into any of his work yet or any of his music, and just the way that he writes and like his message and his positivity and just the way he flows. Like he flows in a way that's like it's in sync with the beat, which I hadn't realized that till like he had described that. And then I started listening to his songs. And I was like, oh shit. Like he's an exceptional artist.
Oh, bro, his last album is fire. It's one of my favorite albums that I've been listening. That one is one of my favorite albums right now that's out. J. Cole's newest one is fucking badass. His last song on there, 1985, for sure is super fire. And what he's rapping about is he's talking shit about all the young rappers that are coming up now.
Oh, wow.
And basically what he's talking shit about in the song is he's talking about how all they're doing is riding trends. Snare drums, poppy taglines, just what everybody is doing because it's what's trendy and what's hot. And what he's rapping and saying is that's what made you hot and what made you pop when you're young. But let's see where you're at in 5-6 years and stuff like that. And because he's 33 years old and he's been doing it for a long time. Mm-hmm. And he's saying that like if you don't have a real message behind your rap and shit, you're going to die with
That's where you get the one-hit wonders.
Yes. Yeah,
that happened a lot in the 80s. There was a lot of one-hit wonders in the 80s because music had changed so drastically and synthesizers became a really, really big thing in this new age. And so you had a lot of bands that were
Hairspray.
Yeah, that would play like one or two songs that would be hits and then you'd never hear from them again.
So you know what's popular now and what's happening is with this ability to upload and get music and get stuff up and out there to all your people so fast. Now it's like it's a content war even in the rap game or in the music game.
Music.
Yeah, so these people are just putting out a lot of shit and it's constantly trendy poppy stuff that's getting released every week, you know, putting out a new song. You just throw some shit together, make sure it sounds cool, put it out there and you're constantly hitting your audience and then hopefully one out of every 10 you hit something that's catchy and trendy and then it makes it into the nightclubs and now everyone's talking
about
it.
That's how you stay relevant.
That's what they're trying to do right now. But what you know, J. Cole's rapping about in this album is that it's short-lived shit. That's what's hot right now for a few years. And if you don't have a real message behind what you're saying and it has some deeper meaning and value to it, then you're going to wash away as all these people grow up. And it's so true. When you're 19 years old, like the stuff that you're kind of into and doing, and then at one point everybody grows up. Mm-hmm. And the funny part, I was talking to Taylor this morning, there's so many parallels to the music industry and the business and even in our business, which you see. I see the same thing in our space in health and fitness. Like to me, the way people some of these people get fame and get traction is through these poppy, trendy type ways by posting half nudes or the mirror selfies or doing cool shit that fucking is over the top or posting all the cool cars. And it's like that gains a lot of traction right now. It's cool. But what those people that are thinking that's cool, they're 17 to 23, 24 years old. What happens when those 24-year-olds are 35 and 40?
Mm-hmm.
Like, does that shit still attract them? Are they still? Probably not. And so if you're not adding any value to those people's lives, you don't have a real fucking business. All you have is a million eyes on you right now. And anybody who's got a million eyes can turn, you know, a t-shirt line, a supplement line. You could turn around.
Maybe and, here and there, but right. long term.
Yeah, but long term, why are those people going to stick around? Because once they're over that trend or why they're following you right now, if you're not adding value to their life, then it's going to be like, why am I?
Bringing back to music, I think that's why I'm always seeking something that sounds unique and challenging on some level. Like, it might not be like a super comfortable beat that you get into right away, but it's interesting as fuck. And I miss the artistry. I miss the weirdness. Like, there was a period, I think, that why I'm sort of like in a time capsule with. There was this period where, like, you had, you know, bands that came out that were really, like, weird, you know, like they were weird. They had weird sounds. They had, like, you know, like a stage presence in a show that was, like, you know, kind of trippy or different. Or I look for all the actual artists that still exist, you know, that aren't just like trying, you know, that they're just hustling to, you know, to be popular and gain traction, you know, based off of that. There's a total, like, you can just see it.
Mm-hmm. There's definitely a difference between artists and performers. Sometimes there's both, right? You have an artist who's a great performer. That's when you hit it out of the ballpark. That's when you get like Lady Gaga's kind of like that, or a Madonna or whatever. Artist who's also
a great performer. Those are true.
It's very true. But what you have right now is and it's been like this for a while. It's not just right now. It's, you have a lot of performers. So these are people who are handsome or pretty. They dance really well. They can sing really well. And someone writes their music for them and creates their persona, creates their wardrobe, and tells them what they're going to do and how they're going to sound. And this is what they're going to do.
Well,
artists have no choice. Artists are just who they are. And many times you can tell because they're fucking weird. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? They'll get on stage and they'll perform. And I don't know about you guys, but I enjoy seeing a singer or a rock band or a performer who you can tell is awkward on stage. Like, when they sing, they don't look polished. Like, they don't make good faces or they don't move very well. And it's like, oh, that's somebody who's just, they're just feeling the shit. They don't even know what they look like. They're just going.
Well, today's generation of artists, and even in our space, is this hacking the algorithm. Like, that's what it's all about. It's all about hacking the algorithm and, like, what gets more views, what gets more likes, what do people gravitate towards because it resonates with them, or it reminds them of something else. So that the book Hitmakers gets into this. It's a really good read along these lines of what we do. It's natural for us to gravitate towards things that seem familiar to us. So,
you know who does this well? Bruno Mars.
Right.
Bruno Mars, you hear a lot of his music and you're like, whoa, that sounds like Motown, or that sounds like 1980-something.
Michael Jackson.
Yeah, because he brings that familiarity.
Except that's another band, though. He just went on that track with this band that was like a funk band. Mm. Yeah, but that track, I love that track.
Yeah,
The other hack is they feature all kinds of artists. So that's one thing too that I love about J. Cole, is like, that's like his thing, is like, I don't feature nobody on my album, right? He just, it's always him and it's always his music that he writes, right? Where some of these artists, if you think about it, like it's like podcasting game, right? When you have another big podcast come on your show, it's inevitable you're going to get X amount of people that come over. So what these rappers do and other, not just rappers, I mean pop stars, everybody does this, is they feature all these other people at their level. So if you got a million people, I got a million people, he's got a million people, she's got a million people.
Smart business.
Feature you all on my album, I'm going to get X amount of your artists are going to come over and listen to my album just because you're on it. And so a lot of these guys do that. But again, like these purists, like a J. Cole type of artist, they're just like, fuck that. That's whack. That's weak. That's hacking the system. That's hacking the algorithm just so you can get more traction. And the youngsters that are doing it are kind of like, fuck you, I'm getting paid.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, so that whole 1985 song is about that. It's kind of tough.
Do rappers today, because I know what happened to rock and pop and all that stuff, is used to be most performers wrote their own music. So most performers were artists. And then it changed, and now most performers don't write their own music. They just perform it and sing it. Is it like that with rap too? Most rappers don't write their own.
It was interesting. I think that's why I was so impressed with Logic when I was like watching the whole thing, is because he can even sing. Like he writes and his own melody, and like he works with this
piano, does everything.
Yeah, this DJ who's constructed all the beats like with him, alongside him. So it's like they're both, you know, together, like producing it themselves, which is pretty fucking impressive.
How crazy is it that we, or how interesting, I should say, is it that we value the ability to entertain us and sing and do that kind of stuff so much that some of the highest paid people in the world are these performers and artists. When you actually break it down, you think about like, well, what are they doing? They're not making anything. They're not creating a more efficient, you know, way of getting water or food. They're not creating shelter or clothing. They're just...
they're expressing how we feel through music.
Yeah, yeah. And so how much we value that. It's crazy, right?
Yeah, well, no, there's something about it for sure. I mean,
I'm not saying it's not valuable. Obviously is valuable. No, it's just interesting.
Oh, it's extremely valuable to us. I mean, it's if there's nothing like listening to a great song that... And, you know, part of what I always realize, like the songs that like resonate with me or that I'm listening to, it's because of where I'm at in my life right now.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
You know, like that song right now, I kind of have the same feel about looking at everybody in our space.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like you out here trying to get all this attention by doing all this funny shit and stuff like that. Meanwhile, I'm over here busting our ass trying to build a legitimate business that provides values for people's life. Sure, you may be popping off right now and everybody knows who you are because of the things that you're doing and the way you're getting attention, but that's okay. I'll be here in 10, 15 years. And so that shit gives me, just even saying that gives me goosebumps because that's what the song is all about. So when you connect with music like that I think that, and there's another good song on their Photograph, which is basically talking all about Instagram and like, and that whole hype and what that's all about. So when you write about stuff that I think speaks to how you feel and you connect with it, I mean, that's where these artists are really talented, really good. And this is where it brings really good value. Then you have the other side, which is the poppy, trendy, the beats, the sounds, the things that like I'm drawn for on at least on the rap side of music, I'm drawn to the lyrics. I'm drawn to the message behind what you're saying. Like that's really cool to me. Like there's certain genres that I want to hear. That's what I want to hear. And there's certain stuff that there's certain times that I just want to hear angry, loud music in my ear because I'm going to go rip up some weight and it doesn't have to have this deep meaning behind it. Right.
Oh, I forgot. I got to tell you guys. So I had bought some steaks, some grass fed steaks from Whole Foods. And I had some from ButcherBox.
Were they now? Are they the? Did it just say grass fed? Or are they grass fed and grass finished?
Grass fed, grass finished. Expensive as hell.
Okay.
Did you merge the two together?
So I just made a bunch of them. Had some people. Yeah. Hung out with some people.
Did you do a taste test?
Uh huh.
You did, dude.
I don't. ButcherBox is. Wait, it's good.
Yeah, no, it's good.
It's very good. Grass-fed meat.
I'm already getting people inboxing me that after the first commercial that we did with them have now ordered and got through their first stuff.
It's good, and the price is good for the quality. It's ridiculous.
Yeah. I hope they're going to be one.
I've been grilling burgers up like crazy. I did the one where you get all meat, you know, all the beef, and they threw an extra hamburgers with it too. So it's like it was awesome. I got to just eat that like with my kids all weekend.
That's the future of food is fascinating to me right now, what's going on. You know, here's the other one. I just was at Whole Foods earlier because I stopped by there to get some macadamia nuts on my way here, and there's a sign out there. I didn't know that. I haven't done this, but you know that, you know how Amazon partnered with Whole Foods? Mm-hmm. You can order groceries and it's in your house in 2 hours.
Oh, wow.
Free, by the way.
That's crazy.
Won't cost you anything.
So I told you that I think this year, end of this year or next year, that we're going to start seeing, you guys know that we're going to start seeing all the Whole Foods convert half the registers to Amazon Go.
Wow. Mm.
So it's happening. Makes sense. And I don't remember, I was told that it was, and I don't know if I'm supposed to be sharing this, so but I won't use names. So it's supposed to happen either the end of this year or next year.
Wow.
We'll start seeing half the registers will be Amazon
Go. Get ready for the protests.
Oh, dude, it's coming.
You're going to get a lot of protests. Serious? You're going to get a lot of employees protesting. Oh, my jobs are being taken.
But at the same time, oh, my God, I can't wait to not be stuck in a fucking grocery line forever.
Dude, totally. Oh, totally.
It's around the corner,
That's
man.
So rad. Yeah. So I'm going to read you guys. I'm going to give you guys a little quiz here. See what you guys see if you guys answer correctly.
All right.
Which of the following kills more people per year? Okay. You guys ready?
Yeah.
Toilets. Ooh. Shark attacks.
Yeah.
Taking selfies.
Selfies.
Has to be selfies.
Selfies kills more people than shark attacks.
Wait a second. So where did you
get? Of course. Why did you put toilet in there?
Because you could also look that up and people off the toilet and die. Yeah.
That's happened.
Yep.
Oh my
god. Happens a lot.
I guess.
Dude. So
I
guess
you're really old.
So yeah, selfies will kill on average something like 8 to 15 people a year, and shark attacks are usually around 7 or something like that. But how funny is it that
the selfie epidemic?
I have zero fear of taking a selfie, but do not get me in the ocean where my feet don't touch the sand, because I for sure think I'm going to get attacked by a shark.
Get eaten. Yeah.
How crazy is that? Our perception's so fucked up. You know what I mean? That a shark attack is so much scarier than
it's getting that out of control with the phone thing, isn't it?
Oh yeah. So
like I seriously have seen people holding their phone out like this, like FaceTiming while walking through an intersection,
dude.
So, I was like, what the fuck are you doing?
I'm reading this article and it talks about how like someone fell at the Grand Canyon because they were backing up. They just fell off the cliff. How shit is that, dude?
Oh my God, dude.
You're like backing up. Oh, like, shit.
Like, wait a minute. I don't have all of it in.
Yeah, and you just fall off the cliff.
Some kid DM'd me when we were talking about it the other day where I talked about, is it happening over in the Midwest and stuff? And he's like, oh no, I forget what college he goes to. And he's like, it's just as bad over here. He goes, in fact, it's so annoying. He said that he won't be on his phone. Somebody will be like on their phone walking straight for him. And he says he doesn't get out of the way. He'll intentionally let them run into each other. Like, and he goes,
I'm a human being. Yeah, we're in like, physical world here.
It's crazy, man. Yeah. Well, I told you guys before, I saw this article a long time ago when this all started happening, is over in China, they have lanes. They have walking lanes. Like, we have car lanes, they have walking lanes for on the phone or off the phone. Like, you can get ticketed if you don't fucking.
No way.
Yes, you get a
ticket. That makes so much sense.
Yes, you get like.
Especially in the city.
Right. Think about that. I mean, it's heading that way. I mean, God, now I look too when I'm in traffic. I'll look to my left, right, in front. I mean.
Yeah.
It's everybody
on the swivel, dude.
Yes. Yeah, everybody is on their phone, dude. Yeah. Everybody is.
Self-driving cars will help. Hopefully will solve a lot of that.
It will.
And that's still going to take a long time to get all that going.
It's going to take a while.
There's going to be a lot of selfie deaths.
At some point it'll be illegal to drive your own car, but it's going to take a little while to do that.
Yeah.
How fast do you think that will take that? Because here's what's tripping me out. So I was up in the city. Visiting my brother's got a new place. He's renting a new place.
I saw that. Great view.
Oh yeah.
Bro. That's awesome, dude.
He lives in this like, and it's a two-bedroom apartment, okay? Two-bedroom. So him and his cousin.
Don't tell me how much it
costs. They're both in their early 30s. They're both bachelors, so it's going to be a great time for them. And they both make a shit ton of money. They're both very successful. But still, two-bedroom apartment in this building is like $6,000 a month.
Oh my God, you just punched me right in the nuts.
For two bedrooms, dude.
That's over $1 million mortgage, man.
But it's great. The building's incredible. It's like a resort. Then you go up to the top floor and there's freaking barbecues and fire pits and all this other. So it's
badass.
It's badass, but $6,000.
It's $6,000.
Oh my God. Absolutely insane. I don't remember what direction I was going with that.
I don't know. It's just that.
Yeah. Well, you're asking about how long we think it was going to take cars to be self-driving.
Yeah. So when we're there, so my brother, who's a car aficionado, he's like, yeah, dude. He goes, I'm getting rid of my car. And I'm like, well, you know, your work isn't super close, like to walk every day. He goes, you don't need to, dude. He goes, these freaking electric bikes are everywhere. It costs $2 to turn that fucker on, and I think like 15 or 20 cents a minute, just like the those scooters outside.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know how fast these bikes go?
Yeah.
Like 35, 40 miles an hour.
Wow.
So you just you pull up your app, and that's what they do every day to go to work. They pull up their app. There's the nearest one. They walk to it, which is like a 2-minute walk because they're all over the city.
Wow.
They hop on the bike. They cruise to work, which is fucking motorcycle.
What was the car that Dr. Molly got into?
Zip car.
It was like the Zip car.
Yeah, it's another company, but it's like a Zip car.
But these are bikes, and what's great about the bikes is because parking's a pain in the ass.
Oh, awesome. Dude, that's brilliant. I didn't even think about that.
They're everywhere. They're everywhere. They're orange, and they're these orange bikes. You can pedal them, so you pedal them to get started. Then you hit the
I wonder if they fixed the problem with all the buses, because like I know that used to be a big concern, because all these tech companies that moved up into San Francisco, like they would shuttle people in these humongous buses.
I don't know.
And like just take up like all the parking spots. Like everybody gets so pissed off.
Yeah, I have no idea, but I was asking them about that because my cousin Alex has lived in the city now for maybe 5 years. So he's been there for a while. So he's like a local now. He's been there for a long time. And he goes, dude, he goes, it's taking over. These electric bikes are taking over. He goes, everybody uses them.
I told Katrina that I believe that this, because we're right in the middle of like deciding if we're going to buy a new car right now or not. And I told her, I'm like, if we do, I said, I really believe this is the last car we buy.
Yeah.
I'm also, if we get the one we really want.
Isn't that weird?
Get the fucking one weird. You really want, because this is, I don't see us buying another vehicle or two after the next. Maybe each of us have one more and then that's it, because I think in the next, because a vehicle gets you a good 10 years, you know what I'm saying, if you take good care of it. In 10 years, if this is what it looks like right now.
Yeah, I feel like it is coming. You know what's interesting though too, I guess there's a group and like there's a whole petition and signing like already for like human rights as far as like driving is concerned. So they're like, because of, let's say, like you're in one of these automated cars, like to give you the right to take over and drive it, you know, let's say, like, you know, something happens with the government or whatever and everything gets shut down where, like, they tell you can't drive, you know.
Oh.
So it's like almost like trying to preserve human rights to drive, which I'm like, what? I'm trying to wrap my brain around
that.
I don't know.
That's very interesting. I could see something like that. What always worries me, and this probably will be a movie, I'm sure, where everybody's in these self-driving cars and just one hacker gets in there and just can cause just serious
havoc. Well, that too, yeah.
Something like that. But yeah, dude, these electric bikes are like little scooters. You get on it, 35, 40 miles an hour. You go through traffic. You're in the city. You get there way faster than if you drove. Yeah. Like, how freaking amazing is that?
It makes a lot, especially in the city. It makes perfect sense.
It's so cool. So I got another cool article I want to... let's see. Sunday was Earth Day. You guys knew that, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I saw it all celebrate over.
Earth Day?
I didn't know
that. It's not on Instagram. Everybody's like all Mother Earthy.
So Earth Day, obviously, you know... conserve the earth and make sure it's safe, all that stuff. So I was reading this article about the first Earth Day in 1970 and some of the predictions that the scientists made on that day. One prediction was that the population will inevitably and completely outstrip whatever small increases in food supplies we make. And they predicted that the death rate will increase until 100 and 200 million people per year will be starving to death during the next 10 years. Never happened. Other people predicted that we would have a great ice age. Never happened. These other people said that there will be, between the years 1980 and 1989, 4 billion people will die. Other people said that by 1980 something, we'll reach peak oil, where we'll be able, that's it, we're not going to be able to get any more oil, and that'll cause catastrophic collapse of the world. Now, let's look at what's actually happened. Mm-hmm. Oh, and then some people said that they predicted that life expectancy will drop down to 49 years because pollution will get so bad by the year 1990. So let's look at what happened. Life expectancy went up. Far less people are starving. The world's poor has dropped. It dropped more in the 20th century than it did in all years combined for humanity. And most of it happened in the last, you know, 40 or 50 years. Pollution has actually decreased in developed nations. Oil, not only did we not hit peak oil, but we have more oil today than we did back then because new technology allows us to access it all. So it's just a reminder for people when we hear these doom and gloom predictions, especially from these environmental scientists who tend to look at things that way. Like, don't count out our ability to innovate and become efficient. And don't count out that there is a market for things to be clean, and there is a market for efficiency. And we tend to, we seem to be improving in most of these areas. So I just want to remind people of that, because I saw a lot of these posts. And there's definitely bad things that have happened and bad things that tend to happen. But a lot of these posts are like, oh my God, everything's going to end and the whole world's going to end.
The Chicken Little.
Remember Al Gore?
The sky is falling.
You guys remember, remember Inconvenient Truth with Al Gore, right? Where he talked about by 10 years ago, he predicted that the polar ice caps would be completely melted, that, you know, sea levels would have risen so much that coastal cities would be underwater. Of course, that never happened. So just be weary about these kinds of predictions, because sometimes, many times they're wrong, but sometimes they're also motivated politically, because if you're a politician and you can scare somebody, then you can get them to vote for you. And that's just an old game. So saying they're always wrong, not saying they're always right, just saying pay attention.
And I think too, like, if you see like somebody that's a gross polluter, you know, like what attractive, if you're a business owner and you're just like negligent and you're just like polluting and just frivolously getting rid of all your shit, like, what is that going to do to propel your business forward? Like, people are going to catch on to that quickly. I just don't see that being the mentality. I know that people want to add, you know, like, sort of demonize and put certain people in a certain light. And it's just like, in today's date and today's climate, you just can't get away with that shit.
No, and you have to understand, like, if people want something, that means there's a market for it.
Nobody wants that shit.
Yeah, do people want clean air? Do they want clean water? Do they want clean land? And the answer is yes. People do that. They do want it. In fact, here's your evidence right here. Just look at the market for products. it's now a selling point to say that this has less, you know, waste, that this was produced with less CO2, that this is recyclable or recycled or whatever. And people will spend more on that kind of stuff. So it shows you that there's, and by the way, that comes from wealth. It doesn't come from, so the more money people tend to make, the more they tend to value or at least have the money to, because when you're poor, you don't give a shit if something's made out of a recyclable container. You're just like, I just need food. I can't afford to spend another dollar on something that's eco-friendly. Mm-hmm. But people kind of want that. Now, I do understand that there are things where there may not be a market for example, things that may happen 100 or 500 years from now. So I understand environmental protections and those types of things. So I'm not necessarily anti that kind of stuff. But there is a market for these kinds of things. Here's another great example. We've had conversations on the show several times, and there was one recently where we were talking about if there was if society was voluntary, like poor people would be left to die, or homeless people would be left to die, and all that stuff. I just read this. I just watched this. It was like a short documentary on Reason, which is, by the way, a great Facebook page to follow. And it was there was this man who, you know, he had been homeless a few times growing up. And so he had a real soft spot in his heart for people who are on the street. And in LA right now, I don't know if you guys know this, there's an epidemic of homelessness. I think it's like over 25,000 homeless people.
That's a lot.
There's whole areas are just
tent communities.
Communities, like crazy, right? And so this guy's like, man, we need to figure something out. So he built.
I saw this article, yeah.
So he built these little homes out of like plywood,
ship
2x4s.
Containers, right?
He built them. They cost them $1,200 to build. Okay. They were solar powered, so you could actually charge your phone in there. There was light in there. There was a bathroom that you could use, but you'd have to empty. Just a very small temporary house, but better than a tent and you know, much cleaner, safe, because so you could leave your stuff there, go try and find a job, come back, and your stuff isn't stolen or thrown away or whatever. And so he built one for this lady that was a homeless lady that was outside his house that he became friends with. And then other homeless people came and approached him and said, you know, can you build one for us too? So he started a GoFundMe campaign. And within a short period of time, like a week, he generated $100,000.
Wow.
And built a whole bunch of these little homes or small homes, or I think they were called.
Like molecule homes.
And he put them out. And he put them out on private land. So like parking lots where, you know, a business says, yeah, you can put a couple over here. Or churches, a lot of churches said you can put them here. And also under big overpasses with big sidewalks where they put them. So he built a whole bunch of these homes for these people. So what does the fucking city do? The city collects all the houses, kicks everybody out, collects them all and goes and fucking demolishes them.
No way,
yes,
bro. Dude.
Yes. And this has happened when people have tried to feed the homeless people. You know how many times there's been situations where people have tried to organize, where they get a bunch
Such
of people together,
bullshit,
and the city
dude.
Comes in and shuts them down. Yeah. And so when people tell me we have to have government in order to provide these things for homeless people, because if we don't, nobody will take care of them.
Right.
Bullshit.
Yeah, it's pure bullshit.
Try and help them and watch what they do. They'll shut your ass down. They make it illegal. There's a lot of cities where it's illegal to organize feeding the fucking homeless unless you go to the city, get all these permits, get all these regulations, and by the time you're done, fucking, you know, it's costing you twice as much as much headache. It's absolutely made me so angry to see this. Because I'm like, why would they do that? And there is a market. People want to help other people. There's just, I can't believe that there's hurdles.
Yeah.
It's insane that they would do that.
That's so fucking frustrating.
Yeah, it made me so angry to see that, because it was a good thing that he did. $100,000 a GoFundMe that he raised. And you know what would have happened? Let's say he did that and it was successful and it got a little bit more attention. How much you want to bet he would have gotten another $100,000 in a GoFundMe? Yeah,
that's just
more.
A guy that had a good idea, you know, and he just wanted to help. It's not like... And that's the thing. It's like we talk about charity. It's not just like driven from, you know, church or community. It's like just one person is like, oh, wow, I could help this situation here. I have this great idea. Who wants to help me and back me? Guess what? People respond. Dude, they don't need the fucking government to come in and mandate the whole thing.
I've had this idea for at some point. I want to start a nonprofit at some point, and I'm not quite sure who I want to help. But one of the ideas that I came up with was if you're homeless or if you're disenfranchised, one of the most difficult things to do is initially get a job. And part of the reason why it's hard is because laws have made it illegal to pay people less than a minimum wage, and I know why they try to do that, but if let's say minimum wage is $12, a McDonald's or whoever isn't going to pay someone with zero skills who may be homeless or maybe have a prison, they're not going to pay them $12. They're going to pay someone else $12 because that person's not hireable at $12 an hour. But if we made it possible for them to hire them at, let's say, $4 an hour or whatever, they may do it. And in return, that person builds skills and proves that they have the ability to do what they can.
Right, it gives them some momentum too for themselves.
And so one of my ideas, and I guarantee it would never happen. It would be very difficult and almost impossible, would be to create a business where we could produce something of value and I can employ people for a lot less than the minimum wage. Therefore, it allows to sell the product for less so we can at least profit to continue running this business, but also give people an opportunity to build some skills. So you can come here and say, look, I'm homeless. I have no skills. I've been on drugs and this and that, but I'm going to prove to you, and in return, you can pay me whatever, $6 an hour, and I'll prove to you. And I'll say, no problem. Will you do this? And I tell you what, in 6 months, you show me you're doing a good job, and we'll give you more opportunity. Or you could take your resume now go get a job showing that you've had one for 6 months and done a good job. But you can't fucking do that. They would never let you do that. Yeah. You know what would happen? They'd say, I'm exploiting people. Oh, you're exploiting them because you're paying them less. It's just crazy how many hurdles there are in front of us to try and help people, and it makes me so angry. It makes me furious.
I feel you.
This Quah is brought to you by Organifi. For those days you fall short on getting your organic veggies or whole food nutrition, Organifi fills the gap with laboratory-tested, certified organic superfoods to help give your health and performance the added edge. Try Organifi totally risk-free for 60 days by going to Organifi.com. That's Organifi.com. And use the coupon code MINDPUMP for 20% off at checkout.
All right, our first question is from the Training Hour.
Oh, you guys know what that
Who's
is?
Who's that?
Dude, she's fucking hot.
Yeah,
bro.
She's super hot.
Yeah, I've been following her lately.
I'm going to have sex with her later.
Whoa, dude. Hey, man. Hey.
It's Jessica, everybody.
Jessica.
Wait a minute. You were just talking about watching.
Oops. I didn't know. It was all from, a different angle. I don't know.
Can you guys talk about the benefits of using drop sets and the best time to incorporate them?
Oh, dude, I just did this like 2 days ago, and
who encouraged us to do? I don't know if this happened to you, but after we hung out with Robert Oberst, because he's talking about doing drop sets.
I think that's what was in my head. And I was feeling myself, and I'm like, I've been in a little rhythm, been hitting my workouts, feeling stronger. I'm like, and I do this all the time.
Let's press it.
And I pressed it a little too much, and I'm definitely a little more sore than I need to be right now for sure. So
you should try the turmeric.
No, I have been.
Okay.
Actually, when you brought it up the other day, what I hadn't been doing, so I know the gold juice has it in it, but I've actually been taking the four pills a night right now. On nights where either one, my Achilles is really inflamed, and I can feel that because it's still up and down as far as inflammation.
It actually works, dude. It's pretty
crazy. I've been meaning to bring it up and tell you that after you had brought that up, I started using it like that, and I do notice a difference. I actually, if that's what the main reason why I'm using it is just for inflammation and trying, I like using the pills even more than I like using the juice. Mm. The juice I like is like a regular thing or it tastes really good.
It's got other stuff in it too.
Yeah, it has other things in it. Mm-hmm. But if I'm purely just trying to knock the inflammation down, I think there's a higher dose of turmeric in just the pills than there is in the gold
juice. Yeah, because I'll go up to 8 pills a day because I'm messing with it to see how it affects it. So I know the other thing about turmeric is it's very, very, so it's, it's systemic inflammation. So if you have irritable bowel syndrome, if you have headaches, if you have inflamed sinuses or joints or whatever, it balances out the inflammatory response. So, and they have a really good quality one. So I like the ingredients that they use. So as far as drop sets are concerned, so drop sets are, I'm going to kind of explain what they are first, and then we'll talk about the benefits. So a drop set is when, let's say I'm doing a shoulder press, and I grab the 35-pound dumbbells, and I'm doing overhead shoulder press. And let's say I did, 8 reps, and that's my set. What I would do with the drop set is I would do my 8 reps, I drop my 35-pound dumbbells, and then I would grab a lighter set of dumbbells without any rest and go right back into shoulder presses. And so what I might do is I might do 35-pound dumbbells, then when I can't do any more, put them down and grab 25-pound dumbbells. And then when I can't do any more, I might grab 15s or 20s. You can go down in small increments of 5 pounds. You can go down in larger increments, where you're going down 10 pounds or cutting the weight in half. That is that really doesn't make a huge difference. But what drop sets are doing is they allow you to do more reps at higher intensity.
Hypertrophy, dude. The pump.
Big time pump. And you don't need a partner to help you do these. So they're really convenient on your own. Whereas if I'm trying to like rep something out, do whatever, I might need to strip a bar or I might have to have someone do force reps and all these other high intensity techniques. A drop set, you just drop the dumbbells, grab another pair. And in terms of like strength endurance, because that's what I get from this from a performance standpoint, is that strength endurance. Like if I want to have the strength to last in a set that's like 15 or 20 reps, or you know that kind of strength endurance that you might get from football, for example. Football is a great example of strength endurance. It's not pure endurance because you know how long does a play typically last, right? Mm-hmm. Average pay, 30 play, seconds. Yeah, 30 seconds, maybe a minute if it's a longer play, and then you take, you know, 10 to 30 seconds before doing the next play, sometimes longer. And so you got to be able to repeat that. You got to be able to repeat that exertion over and over again playing football. And so what you develop with a sport like football is something called strength endurance, the ability to go hard, take a quick break, and then repeat that. And drop sets tend to do that for performance. As far as bodybuilding is concerned, drop sets are probably, I would say, maybe the top or at least one of the top three.
It's a advanced, massive pump.
Yeah.
Producer.
Wouldn't you say that, Adam? It's probably one of the top three.
I also think it's
intensity
one of the things,
building techniques.
I think it's one of the things that gets a lot of people in trouble. And
they overdo them.
They just get, and I'm for sure somebody who was like this too. When you do a drop set, there's no denying the fucking pump.
You get addicted to it.
The way you feel and the way you look.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if you and anybody who's like training in a strength phase where you're 3 to 5 reps, you could do 3 to 5 reps for a whole hour workout and never feel super pumped. I can definitely do that. I can do a full hour workout of strength training and not feel the massive pump in my muscles. Where if I'm drop setting, super setting, and training high reps, you get this massive pump and you got all this and you're drinking your water. You know what I'm saying? So you got blood, you got water rushing into your muscles. You look fucking probably bigger than you've ever looked working out, or that muscle looks the most developed for you. And so it does this psychological thing to so many bodybuilders, and they get stuck in that phase. And I've seen this happen to so many of my peers. And I too have had this happen to me where I fall in love with the burn, the pump, the look that I have right there, that it plays this like, it puts this like psychological twist on you thinking that, oh my God, like look at me, like I look good right now. Even though that all deflates and goes away in about an hour or two.
And there's some benefit to it.
Absolutely, there's also benefit to it. That's why it should be something that's incorporated intermittently. So typically when I teach it, I teach it when I'm also teaching somebody in a hypertrophy phase. So like in our, you know, phase 2 or 3 of MAPS, I would tell somebody like, hey, because we don't have drop set. I don't think we have drop sets in any. We have it in black.
Does MAPS aesthetic have it?
Yeah, we have it in black, but we don't have it in red. But you could, even someone could use it if you had red.
Maybe phase 3 of red.
Yeah, and we're already in a hypertrophy phase, so we're already chasing the pump in phase 3 of most MAPS programs. So, hey, why not throw some drop sets in there here and there? My body's not used to it. It's different. It's only going to enhance that. So that's typically when I teach it. But there are no rules on when you use it. I think the key is to just not get stuck doing it a lot and using it intermittently as a tool to kind of like shock the system. Yep. And then sometimes personally, because I've been doing this for a long time, I'll even throw it in a strength phase. So maybe I'm 3 weeks into, you know, a lot of heavy five rep stuff. Everything I'm doing is heavy and low reps. And it's like, hey, you know what? I've been in this type of training for 3 weeks. Today I'm going to deadlift, and then at the end of my deadlift I'm going to do some sort of a drop set with it, because I just would never do that after strength, and I would start with 5 and then cut the weight in half, then cut the weight in half again, then cut the weight in half again, and just get this massive pump. But I wouldn't recommend somebody going do that.
This is at best intermediate, but more likely an advanced technique. I wouldn't even recommend this to beginner. And there's some exercises that lend themselves very well to drop sets, and others that not so much. Like,
yeah, deadlift's not a good example.
Yeah, no, I wouldn't do, so like drop sets, when I do drop sets, it's things with dumbbells typically. It's a lot of single joint movements, probably better. Overhead presses, sometimes I'll do drop sets. I did, you know, one time I made the mistake of doing a barbell squat drop set.
Yeah, I've done that before too.
Oh, dude, so, and this is, you know, let me tell you, when this happens, it's never when I'm having a smart workout. It's always when I'm working out with another dude, and you know, we're measuring our dicks basically. Let's see
who can outdo the other guy.
Yeah, so like, you know, and this is what happened. I worked out with DJ and Ryan. You guys remember DJ and my friend Ryan. And, you know, all fit dudes, all very strong. And we were going to do legs. And, I came up with the idea. I'm like, hey, what if we just did a bunch of drop sets for squats, and everybody laughed, and nobody wants to say no, right? Because you don't want to be a pussy. So we loaded up the bar, and we used a bunch of small plates so that we could strip it down like five times.
Yeah.
And let me tell you, dude.
I've done that before.
You know, I'm thinking like, yeah, we're going to do this for like an hour, you know?
Yeah.
No, that was it. We might have done two sets or three sets each, and then that was it. And that was it for a while. I couldn't move for a long time, and I'm pretty sure I damaged my muscles.
I think it was like a week, maybe week and a half to recover after.
Oh,
now, to touch on that, though, this is also how if I was going to do something like that, like a perfect time to do something crazy like that is when I know I only have 10, 20 minutes to work out.
Yeah.
It's like,
yeah.
And 10, 20, and Arnold used to say this, like I could come in and do one set, you know, more effective than someone's entire workout.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that would be an example of that. Like, listen, I'm limited to only 15, 20 minutes today. What can I do to get the most bang for my buck? This is where I might do some of this. Now, that what a lot of guys will do is they still got their hour workout ahead of them. So
that's the Mike Mentzer approach with the heavy duty, what he wrote, you know, in the 1970s was you do one absolute all out set per body part once per week. And, you know, and I do want to say this real quick as I go into this. Here's a quick kind of rule. There's certain laws when it comes to resistance training. None of them are real laws. Like, nothing works 100%. But there's general laws. And one of the general laws is that most techniques will work for most people if they're new or if they're novel.
Mm-hmm.
And everything will not work forever. So if you've never done a drop set and then you do a drop set, you'll probably see some change. Will it work forever? Nope. And a lot of you won't work more than two times, mm-hmm. or maybe more than one time. And so you do get these changes when you do these things. And so Mike Mentzer's book was going to the gym, one all-out set to failure and beyond, and then you're done. If you've never trained that way before and you try that every once in a while, you may actually get some progress out of it. Like Adam says, like, I only have 10 minutes. All right, let's go in there and do this all-out drop set and then leave. Yeah. If you never do that, you might actually see something.
Oh, I really think there's kind of a place for everything, but I, you know, not to sound like a broken record, but I think where everybody goes wrong with all of these types of tools is they just overuse them.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And the psychological part that's hard is that you see some sort of result, and the reason why you see some sort of result or change or difference is 'cause you just haven't done it. So somebody who did that and never done that before, they see this great result and it's like, "Oh shit, that works. Mm-hmm. I'm going to do it again. And then I'm going to do it again. And then I'm going to do it again." And the next thing you know, you love drop setting and you're drop setting all the time in your workouts. And it's like, well, you know, the first three or four times you did that, you probably did see some really good change. Your body did send a signal to adapt. Mm-hmm. But now it's starting to get so used to that, that it's not. So these types of things, the drop sets, the training to failures, the pyramid sets, all these different types of tools, I love to intermittently throw them in my routines, and I absolutely will do that. And a lot of times it is just a test like that. I did it the other day. I overdid it a little bit, but it wasn't like that wasn't me fucking up or a failure. It's like that kind of let me know where I'm at right now as far as my muscle conditioning. I'm just I'm not up to that much volume and that much intensity to where I need to do that.
Like, see, like where I'm at right now, this sounds like really appealing. You know, like, I'm totally going to go do this, you know, because before that, like you said, if I only have like certain amount of time, which this is always something I'm battling, my go-to would be I'm going to do a squat and then I'm going to do an overhead press. And that's just it. I'm going to do those two things. And then the next time I'm going to do a deadlift and I'm going to do a bench press. Mm. And that's those two things. And so it's like, I know I can hammer those out within 20, 30 minutes, get a real solid, you know, workout as far as like my skill and like depth and like, you know, what I'm trying to do mechanically, and load it up properly. But yeah, let's flirt with that when I'm in a pinch like that. Mm. So it does make sense.
Do you guys have a favorite exercise for drop sets? Like, is there one exercise you like to do drop sets the most for?
I mean, I like arm stuff.
Dumbbell bench.
Yeah, yeah. I like arm stuff.
Dumbbell bench is so fun. Really?
For me, I like doing bicep stuff or tricep stuff.
Laterals.
Yeah,
laterals.
Yeah,
that's my favorite to drop set.
Laterals.
It's so easy, right? You just go down the dumbbell.
Yeah.
That's
a good call.
We used to call it running the rack. That was a term that was used in the probably 80s. Now they say drop set. It's drop set, strip sets, run the rack. Those are all mean the same thing. Mm. But that's what I used to call it, run the rack. And what you do is you'd start with your heaviest weight,
and
you would go down dumbbells literally until you hit the
end. This is where you see the 24-hour fitness like fucking apocalypse like Adam blasted me about the other day.
Where all the dumbbells are
just all on the ground. Because you're like, fuck, your arms just fall off. How are you going to put them all back?
Yeah. Hey, did you guys see that? Speaking of 24 Hour Fitness, one of their, I think it's an area manager, said that he has his trainers, all the trainers listen to us.
Yeah, no, I'm getting that more and more now.
Awesome.
In fact,
we have a huge like 24 Hour Fitness influence.
You know what? Now that I'm glad you brought that up because we're already, I don't know if I told you guys or not, I know we're scheduled or we're scheduling right now a Golds and a 24 because I two fitness managers. One GM and one FM reached out to me, and I think most all their trainers listen to the show already, and they listen. And I said it earlier, and I don't know if I've said it on the show. So if you're listening and you're a GM and FM for any of those franchises, and you guys, especially if you're in California, because we're always up and down California, but if you're around and you guys want us to stop,
man, this
through,
makes me so happy.
This is what I love to do this stuff. So then, so do the
It'd
boys.
Be amazing.
This is,
it's like full circle.
Yeah, man. I would, and so a couple guys called me out on that and reached out, and absolutely, we're making time for them as we got a West Coast tour happening right now, and so we're gonna drop in some of the Golds and 24s that reached out. Would love to come by, see the trainers. We could do like a little live Q&A with them and talk to them. So if you're a manager for one of those facilities and you listen and your staff listens, would love to stop by.
Next question is from Eddie the Coach. How do you talk to your kids when you and your ex were getting a divorce and in the transition of moving out?
I'm assuming this is a little bit directed. Yeah.
So, you know, I sat down with my kids and I'm like, hey, listen, you know how you don't clean your room? I'm out of here. No, I'm just kidding. Wow. Just, terrible.
You know,
sorry, I had to break.
You
know, I had to break. Yeah.
Thanks.
It's your fault. No,
you know,
how
I told you that I loved your mom. Well, I don't.
No. You know what? When you're, and this is just, I mean,
this had to have been really tough for you because when you're going through something like this, yeah. I mean, it's already, I'm sure, a fucking, I mean, like you said, probably one of the hardest times of your life. So personally, you already have so much that you're internally dealing with. Yep. And then also, she's probably crazy and dealing with her shit. And then on top of that, you got to think, now, how do I, you know, convey this to my kids
without allowing
my emotions to get involved?
And I did a lot of thinking, a lot of meditating on this. And here's the thing. When you're a child will naturally blame themselves for some, you know, major challenge or trauma in their life. And the reason why they do this, especially when it has to do with their parents, is it's easier for them to think that they did something wrong than it is for them to think that the person who takes care of them.
Yeah, you guys are the superheroes.
Yeah.
Superheroes don't do stuff wrong.
Yeah, and so they internalize it a lot. And so I was very cognizant of that. That was something I was thinking quite a bit. And I thought to myself, well, it's happening, okay? So I can't shield them from this. It's going to happen. I might as well be as honest as possible. I might as well just be very, very honest. And of course, you want to make sure your language is appropriate and how you discuss the things is appropriate for their level of understanding. I mean, if I was getting divorced and my kids were 19, 20, we can get into more depth about what happened with the relationship and the marriage and all that kind of stuff. But you're talking to little kids. You want to talk in language that they can understand. But you want to be as honest as possible because it's difficult regardless. But what will make it more difficult is if they have false hope by saying like, well, you know, we're just going to try things out or I'm going to do this or sometimes things don't work out. And, you know, you want to be as honest as possible. And what I told my kids, we both sat down. I think that's also very important. And this is not always possible for people. But if it is, my best recommendation is both you and your ex or whatever, sit down and talk to the kids together so that they can see. Because another thing that I was worried about is I was worried that my kids would view us no longer as united in raising them. So yes, we are no longer together as a couple, but we are still united as your parents. We're still on the same team, which means when you need something, we're both a team. And when you do, and if something goes wrong, we're both a team. And if she says something, I got her back. And if I say something, she's got my back. Because if they start to view you as separate,
right,
that can be a tremendous stress. It can be a tremendous stress. They don't know what to expect. Kids will start to work you. They'll start to, you know, and you start, and all that guilt and stuff starts to kick in. So we were just super honest. And we sat them down and said, look, you know, your mom and I have decided that we're going to be getting a divorce. Now, this is what that means. It means that we're not going to live together anymore. So, and then they're like, well, where are we going to live? It's like, well, you're going to actually have two houses now, and you'll have two rooms, and you'll be living sometimes here like you normally do, and sometimes you'll be living at a new house, which I'll be living in. But what I want you to know is we're still a family. And this was the big theme of the conversation that we had with our kids was, this doesn't change the fact that we're a family. We're still a family. And let me tell you, when you're going through a divorce, you don't want to hang out with your ex. You just don't. It's just, I mean, obviously, you're divorcing them, right? But when my kids have something, when they're doing something, when it's a sporting event, when it's, you know, a dance recital, me and their mom show up, and we show up together, and we've brought our new significant others, as awkward as it may feel or whatever, because it's important that the kids see that, oh, all these people care about us, and all these people are united and working together. We also told them it's going to be very consistent. I said, look, the same rules that you have now are going to be the same rules you have in the new house. And you know, their mom and I, we talk about these things all the time. We discuss bedtime. We discuss food. We discuss when they do their homework, because it can be very stressful moving from home to home. And what we wanted for the kids was that it would be make it as seamless as of a transition as possible, in the sense that they know that it's the same rules. Like, okay, not a situation where at my mom's house I can leave my room a mess and I do my homework before bed, and then at my dad's house I got to do it right after I go home from school and he lets me stay up later and whatever. It's the same. It's the same. We're a family still. We still work together. The only difference is two houses, two different places to live, and we're just very, very honest, and we answered their questions as honestly as possible. And the questions your kids will ask you are going to be fucking hard, right? Very difficult.
Yeah.
They're going to ask you things like, you know, do you guys still love us? Do you still love each other? Do you still, like, these are very tough questions to answer.
Yeah.
And so they did ask us, like, do you guys not love each other anymore? We said, well, no, actually, we care very much. And I told my kids, I said, your mom is your mom. She's the mom of the children of my kids. No matter what, I'm always going to care about your mom. That's a very special thing, and we're always going to work together. We just don't want to be married anymore, but we do. And then, of course, my youngest didn't understand that, because they're like, well, what's the difference? Why don't you guys just be married then? Because they don't understand that whole,
yeah,
that other whole aspect of it. So that was a tough one, but you just got to be as honest as possible with your kids, and try not to sugarcoat her, you know?
I think the united piece is the important. The fact that the mistake that I've seen with, you know, friends of mine that had divorced parents, I had divorced parents, is the parents that, and it's very, very common. It's more common that you see this.
So common.
That you see mom and dad break and divorce because they don't like each other anymore, whatever it may be, or something bad happened. And the partner or the mom and dad have resentment for each other, and they speak through the kids,
right,
about
such
it.
A terrible mistake.
It is a huge mistake.
Terrible. And there's competition between the two.
And I've seen it, and I've seen what happens to the relationship with those kids and the parents that are now adults and their relationship. I mean, I see it in my own family. My sister, who's only a year difference from me, has zero relationship with my stepfather, and she absolutely hates him. And she hates him a lot because my mom hated him. And my mom talked so bad about him so much that it's been ingrained in her head that way. And I've seen that she's done that with multiple people in our family and relationship my sister and I, we're so young. You're 7, 8, 9 years old. So if mom says, dad's an asshole, dad's an asshole. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Or dad's a jerk because he won't pick you up on time. Or dad, she would express how she was feeling with what was going on in their shit. And that is a huge fucking mistake, because it's inevitable. And I know Sal can speak to this. I guarantee his ex pisses him the fuck off sometimes. Yeah. But you cannot let the kids see that.
Right.
If they see that and they see you bad-mouthing their mother at all, even in the slightest bit, like, then you show that division.
Honesty is extremely important. So I could say something like, well, I'm upset with your mom right now, or I'm upset, you know, with the situation. But what you have to understand with children, especially, you know, you get divorced, and you have two parents, is that other parent is the other half of the child. So
yeah,
what you say about, you know, what I say about my kid's mom to my kids, I'm saying about them. This is how they internalize it.
Mm.
So if we're sitting there and I'm telling my kids, your mom is this, your mom is that, and she's this and she's stupid or whatever, you know what my kids would be feeling? They'll be like, oh, like, that's me. That's half me. I'm a lot like my mom, because other people are going to tell them stuff like, oh my God, he looks so much like your mom.
Yeah.
Oh, you're... So now they become, they start to internalize it. And one of two things will happen. Either they'll start to hate themselves, or
they resent you, dude.
They resent you.
They resent you.
Or they pick a side.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And the last thing you want ever to do, and I've seen parents do this, and it's fucking, it's so crazy to me, where they'll have like young kids, and then they'll ask the kids, who do you want to live with? Who do you want to stay with? Wow. Like, what? Wow. And I understand sometimes those situations require that, but like that is a, you're asking a young kid now to hurt someone's feelings and choose someone else, and that can cause a lot of havoc. And that's what happens when you say terrible things about their parent to them. Now, you can be honest. If your ex is a degenerate, if your ex doesn't show up when they're supposed to and doesn't support and all that stuff, you can be honest and say, look, they have a tough time being consistent, or it doesn't look like that they're, you know, responsible with this. And just be honest. Like, but don't, the vitriol, the negative, the evil comments, the anger, like, keep that for yourself. It has, you know, don't,
you got to pull your emotions out of it.
It's a,
be able to speak the honesty and the truth of what's happening, but at the same time to take out the emotions and the feelings that you're
right.
feeling of resentment, anger,
that's
bitterness.
Right. One
like
thing
that
is
that can't come out in your conversation with the kids.
One thing is for sure, like, my kids know that their mom and dad are like, we may not agree on a lot of things, but together we're a fucking team when it comes to raising them. And when my kids ask me something, like, my son will be like, hey, can I have a new phone? I'll be like, did you ask your mom? And the reason why I'll ask is I want to make, if you didn't, then okay, well then maybe I'll answer. But if you did, what did she say? Because I got to back her up, and she'll do the same thing. Because I want them to know, like, okay, they're a team. Even though they're not married, I still have two parents that are a team.
And you have to set that foundation now, because it's inevitable. When they become teenagers, they're going to try and work the system.
Oh, they're going to know.
Yeah, they're going to try and work the system.
What they want.
Yeah, you go ask mom these questions, you ask dad that, they'll know who to ask what, and they'll play you guys against each other. And so you got to have established that solid foundation early.
Be a fucking mature adult. Like, don't be a fucking kid, man. Like, be an adult. Like, here, I'll tell you what. There's holidays, and you have to split the holidays, which is tough for a parent. Like, you know, they're not with me on Christmas, so they're going to be with their mom on Christmas, or they're with me on Easter, so they're not with her. And that's a difficult, especially the first ones, right? Those are real tough. So what we do, and we don't do this on all of them, but we've done a couple times, especially for the more difficult ones like Christmas, where they were with me on Christmas, and their mom was kind of having a tough time, and I could tell. Mm. And the kids were kind of like, oh, are we going to see mom on Christmas, this and that? And here's the other side of it. I have a girlfriend also who, you know, we live together, so it's also her house. So I'm not trying to impose anything, because I also want to respect, you know, Jessica's space as well. But luckily, I'm with someone that is also extremely mature and wise. And so what does Jessica do? She calls my ex and says, hey, look, you know, I know the kids are with us on Christmas, but if you'd like to come over, we're going to have, you know, hot cocoa or whatever, watch the kids open their presents from Santa Claus and hang out a little bit. And I know I guarantee you, for my ex, that's not the most comfortable situation to come over with my house and my girlfriend's house or whatever. But you know what? She did it because, of course, she wanted to see the kids, but she also wants the kids to see that we're beyond, like, that stuff's there, but what's more important is that we're all a team.
That's huge that she did that.
Oh, and we've done that now for several holidays, and it's getting easier, and it ain't easy. It's I'll tell you something, it's fucking not easy. Look, you know, the first time we did it, I don't remember where we were. My daughter had a dance recital, and so I brought my girlfriend, my ex brought her boyfriend. It was the first time everybody met. My parents were there. My ex's dad was there, cousin. So it's also other extended families now that are seeing these other people.
Oh, wow.
And so we all showed up, and, you know, everybody was cool, and the kids saw us all together. It was all good. On Easter, we all went to, you know, we all did the church service together, because, you know, my kids go to the Catholic school. Mm-hmm. Afterwards, you know, I did this. This was my thing. And I said, hey, let's all take a big family picture. And I said that loud in front of my kids so they could see everybody's fucking cool. And we did. We took a big picture together, and that's all it. And it's, again, it's not perfect, but just be honest. Just be totally honest and be mature adults about it, because I firmly believe the damage that's caused from divorce is small, in small part the fact that that there's a big change where the two parents aren't together. But I think it's in large part to the shitty way that parents tend to handle those situations. So there's a lot more in your hands than you think.
Good, a good habit to practice is, because it's inevitable that your ex will piss you off. That's just how it's inevitable. That will happen. Is when those moments come, do not communicate with your kids. Just separate yourself from your children for a while. Let yourself cool down. Let yourself process what you just went through with them. Swear in your room. Go to your friend. Tell them what a bitch she is. Do all that stuff with to the people that you can talk to. Then fucking gather yourself and have your conversation with your kids when you have to. But do not
get a punching bag.
I think that's the biggest mistake I see people have, is they get fired up emotionally because the ex is an idiot. They always, that's why they're your ex.
Dude, I see. So, I know people. I know families where, you know, they're divorced and everything, and dual custody. So it's not like they're like one of them degenerate, you know, whatever. But they hate each other so much that they'll roll up to the house and they'll fucking just drop the kids off. They don't even get out of the car or anything. Like, peace. And it's like this, what they don't realize they're doing is they're creating this imaginary division.
Oh, yeah.
They won't even say hi to the other person. You know what I'm saying? Where I'm 100% honest. Like, I don't want to say hi to my ex at all afterwards. It's like, I want to hang out with her, but you better believe I drop the kids off. I go up, say hi to her. Hey, how's it going? Great. Because I want them to see, like, oh, cool, they communicate and they're all together. They're on the same team. Right. It just takes another level of, I think, maturity, but I think it's worth it.
Next question is from the Girls Gone Wad podcast.
Oh, yeah, our girls.
It's friends.
Yeah.
Very important question. How do you fold your toilet paper? Do you crumple it or fold it?
That's what?
Wow.
Are you a folder or a crumpler?
Apparently.
Is like the wipe standing up or sit down?
Apparently, this is like a big, like, there's a big division. Right?
There is.
Really?
Big division.
Yeah. Well, are you guys folders or crumplers?
I'm trying to think.
I'm very serious about my bathroom toilet paper time. So
yeah, you know, I'm a crumpler.
I do the whole roll thing and then I smash it.
Yeah, you're a folder, aren't you, Adam?
No, I'm a crumpler. I'm a two-time crumpler and two wiper.
Whoa! What do you mean?
So I do two crumples.
Oh, right. Two wipes.
He's advanced.
Yeah, and then I get two wipes.
What if you need an extra wipe? You don't. It's always two and two.
Two and two is all.
It's a hard. That's it.
Yeah, it's a hard. That's
what
it.
If there's a lot of stuff?
Yeah, well,
that's two. See, sometimes I only need one. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Sometimes one's only. You know, if it's a clean.
I always go for an excessive amount. Even
a clean break means one and one. But yeah. That's the two and two is like the norm. You know?
So the wipes, you know, that's the thing that you introduced to us.
Changed your life. Probably.
Yeah, and you know what?
You're welcome. That's probably why you got some roadhead the other
you
day.
You know. I'm sure it contributed. And thanks for outing that. Yeah. I was trying to like skirt around that.
Yeah.
But
oh, my wife's gonna love it.
I just guessed. I mean, you're driving the car and you're
you
pulling around.
You guess, asshole.
You guys playing footsies while you're driving.
So I read somewhere that the wipes are they not good for the environment?
Well,
or
of course
like
they're not. So either is fucking flushing toilet paper. Nothing's good for the environment anymore.
I don't know.
What the fuck is good for the environment?
Is this biodegradable kind? Is there?
Or they plug up toilets and stuff like that.
I don't know. Maybe some forward-thinking company's making it.
Yeah, someone was saying, so here's an article, wet wipes are a huge environmental problem.
Huge.
Yeah. Oh,
really?
Yeah. You know,
I think plastic's a lot worse.
Well, I think selfies are worse.
Yeah. you know what, though? This is such a classic thing, right? Consumer society.
You know, the last time we talked about this, I did get a bunch of DMs from people. You know, you really shouldn't flush those down the toilet.
Man.
Oh, dude, go fly a kite, bro. Yeah, stop taking
your. Yeah, but have you seen
stop
my
taking
asshole?
Your selfies? I'll stop using my wife's,
have
dude.
You seen how squeaky clean my asshole is?
That's right, dude.
You know what we should do is make bidets popular again, dude.
Oh, there you go.
Like, or not popular again, popular, because that's a big thing in Europe.
So quite a few of the houses that we've been staying at.
Why that never caught on?
Actually, a lot of the houses that we've stayed at have had them.
Have you used them one yet?
Yeah.
So
I've been using them a lot.
So I'm going to confess.
The house
I've never used one before.
You can't be too strong. Yeah, like I just imagine this.
I've never used one.
Like,
how does it work?
Penetrating.
Start to finish? What do? You wipe first with paper?
Yeah.
Or you go straight into the.
No. You still do your normal process over there. Then they have it right. The toilet's right next to it. Then you hop your butt right over there. And then there's a hot, cold, and then a nozzle thing. And you. The thing that sucks is when you're getting on somebody else's that you've never been on before. I've noticed since we've been in all these different houses, there's probably been, I would say, all the houses that we've traveled to,
And it's just like a sink, or does the water spray up?
It sprays straight up.
So you have to sit over it.
You have to be right on it, right? Because you could shoot up a little far up the front or up the back. So you gotta hone in on the target there.
So it just sprays straight up.
Straight up. If you were to,
Use your hand with soap and everything, or
you don't even touch it.
Hand.
It's enough.
Well, I don't know, Justin. I've never done this before.
It's enough pressure. Okay, you're sitting. Imagine if you're sitting.
Is there soap or is it just water?
No, it's just water.
It's just a water wash.
Yeah, it's just a water. That's why you still need to do the.
You're like power washing your ass.
Exactly what's happening.
That is what. Yeah, that's what's happening.
So you stand. You squat over it. You don't sit on it.
No, you sit on it like a toilet.
Oh.
So you still sit on it. And when you sit on it, you know, I imagine, I haven't seen a camera view, but I'm imagining if I sit down, it probably naturally spreads my ass cheeks a little bit.
Yeah.
And then the nozzle part is, you know, lined up with your butthole.
Yeah.
And then you turn it on. There's warm and cold. Ooh. Well, yeah, some people really like it.
What'd you say?
It's a little
deep clean. Yeah, you know what I mean?
It's a little
deep clean.
It's a little weird for me. But no, yeah. I mean, I'm for sure when I actually customize my house,
isn't there poop in it then afterwards?
Wow.
No, because you've done a good job of getting the serious stuff on the first go around. So when you first wipe,
it's just like the film.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Wow. So yeah.
It gets rid of dingleberries. You know what I'm saying?
You sit on it.
Before they become dingleberries are because people let that shit fucking dry up on their shit and it's disgusting.
Yeah.
That's why I've always been a wipe guy. Like, you got to get rid of all of that, all the lingering stuff. Otherwise,
then you got to shave that asshole.
Right. Or both.
Let's go there.
Yeah. No, I think bidet's got to be the way to go because it's safe. You don't have to throw things away. There's no waste. And
it would
it's
be
cleaner.
It would be ideal.
It's cleaner.
So so everybody knows that all the fucking.
I know women love them for after sex. That's a big thing. Like in Europe, it's like, after we have sex,
point.
We can.
Yeah.
Yep, wash ourselves.
Right, no, that would be excellent for that. I didn't even think about that. That'd be perfect for that.
We should make a mind pump bidet. Let's make it popular.
Mind bidet.
That's all I got for that one, though, Doug. I can't give you any more. I can't give our girls any more on that. But I'm a crumpler because I think that it creates edges. So like if you fold, like people
you got
that
hard poop, man. No. You need to scrape
it off. Well,
what
does the fold look like? I mean, are they doing origami with this?
No, like a fold is like just a normal, perfect fold that's just thick, right? So it's like wiping your butt with like a...
You just double it up,
like a cloth, you know, because it's so... It's just like our blanket because it's so soft. So some people like that, but I want some edge to mine.
Who's the most likely to plug the toilet?
Justin.
Easy.
Come on, man.
Easy.
Not even
easy. I think he used too much paper. He used a lot of paper.
I do.
What? Why?
Because I'm paranoid. I don't get all of it.
So just a shit ton of paper?
I don't want it on my hand.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anyways.
Who picked that question?
I don't know where to go with
it. I had to. The girl's gone wild.
Yeah.
All right. Our next question is from O'Rourke Q. An asteroid impact is imminent. Do you want to be vaporized immediately or survive with 10% of the people left on the planet? And if so... Where do you go for a safe haven, and how well could you survive?
Dude, that thing's hit me in the face. I'm going out like a G.
You'd rather just die automatically? No, this would be
take me.
This is exactly how I would start my nation, my community.
You can't wait.
Yeah, everybody dying, I'd rise up. All right, everybody, follow me. The squat society.
Great leader.
Yeah, squat and deadlift society.
It's crazy.
What a terrible question.
It's a hard one to think about, but think about all the things that we've gotten so accustomed to that. Like, I even think about, like, watching TV or phones, the cars that we drive. Like, I can't build a car. I couldn't build a TV. No. I can't build a phone. Like, a lot of these things that we...
You've never been hunting.
It would be horrible.
Yeah.
Start over again.
Just think about all the things that we have and that we've become accustomed to using every single day of our lives to the point where we don't even understand how they work. Like, that's how, like, crazy, like, it's become.
Oh, it'd be Stone Age.
It would,
right? It'd be Stone Age right away.
Like, I'd be fucked. Like, I would. Yeah. I mean, I could survive. Like, I feel confident enough.
I think most of us would die.
Really?
Yeah. You know, you have to.
You can make batteries out of lemons.
Bro, but how? So. Like, here's the thing. The natural.
I know that much.
Random fact. Yeah. Where did that come from? Yeah. You can make batteries out of lemons?
That's how the ancients did.
I've seen it. Yeah. Here's the thing that people understand. The natural state of humanity is terrible, grinding poverty, food scarcity. That's the natural state. The way we live now is not natural. We have created a society, it's a miracle, where all these people have somehow worked together to create a situation where we don't have to worry about a whole lot.
Oh, soft, dude. Yeah. Everybody would just get demolished.
Take away, you don't even have to destroy 90% of the world, just take away electronics.
Did that show ever last? The one that was
Naked and Afraid?
Oh, no. I know you've watched it for sure because I think we talked about it a few years back. It was
Last Man on Earth.
No, 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 no. They actually had a reality show where I think 10 people get dropped in. It was based in some area in L.A. Right outside of L.A. And it was basically they had to build their own little community. And there was like there was like one doctor, then there was like an engineer guy, there was like a construction guy, and they all had to kind of work together to build, and they had nothing. You had no outside resources whatsoever. They had to kind of put together this, and they had to figure out how to generate power.
What was the name? Oh my God, you just reminded me, yeah.
Right, you've seen that, right?
I don't think it only lasted like a season, if that.
I know I watched at least one or two seasons of it.
Think about how many people who are super highly skilled that their skills would be so worthless.
Oh, totally.
Us. Like, I'm a good trainer.
Well, that's
I don't
a good
fucking
point.
Care about getting in shape, man. I'm trying to survive. Like, how can you help me?
I want to be a blacksmith. You know what I mean? Have something
that's
like
what scares
tangible.
Me about this question, because I'm thinking, like, I love you guys, right? I love the four of us here. Just, I feel like we could.
You wouldn't pick any of us.
I know I wouldn't.
Yeah, it'd be fucked.
I wouldn't pick myself. You know what I'm saying? Like, I would. This is not a strength of mine.
Dude, look where we live in Silicon Valley. All these tech geniuses would be worthless. You know what I mean? They wouldn't know what to
do. Their stock goes way down.
Their skills are worth nothing. That would be a terrible situation. But, you know, humanity has been through some insane, like the plague. Do you know how many people the plague killed in Europe? One third.
Yeah.
One
third of the entire continent.
Imagine that right now. If one out of every three people that you know
insane.
Died.
Yeah, it's guaranteed one of us is dead.
From an illness.
Okay, I heard about this documentary on Netflix about rats. And so I'm definitely going to watch it, because I guess like they went into like New York and they showed just communities of rats and like how insanely, like how so many of them still like pervade the entire city, like make up more of the population than people. And let's just think if like, and they're all carrying diseases of all kinds of different diseases. Like, who's to say that can't all of a sudden become an epidemic again if all the power goes out, you know, and now everybody's fighting for food and the rats are fighting for food.
Well, you take away power, you take away clean water, you take away sewage removal. So imagine that now what that causes. You take away medicine, you take away obviously information. Every system that we have that supports us it relies on other systems.
Do you guys remember right before Y2K?
Oh yeah, I was actually worried about it.
We had my family had fucking all kinds of canned food.
Really?
We had jugs
of water.
We had tons of jugs of water underneath, under the house in the shade. Like, it was crazy. We had all kinds of.
Did
shit.
Did you really?
Yeah.
Yeah, oh, I feel like that God. Was a. Sometimes I feel like these are like conspiracy Y2K. Theories to sell like canned food.
Totally.
Well, do you remember what the big scare was?
The calendar.
Was that the calendar?
Yeah,
nobody
Aztec
had,
calendar.
Nobody had thought further. Like, oh shit, how are we going to go into the next into 2000? It doesn't make sense. Like, no one had thought to program it out that way.
We've gone beyond, you know, the thoughts of the ancients.
Yeah.
It's awesome.
No, I think the biggest threat. I mean, asteroid is a pretty big threat, mainly because we wouldn't.
Didn't we
see
have
it.
One that just recently just either
passed
just
us?
Missed us?
Yeah, I saw.
Well,
that.
Well, when they say just miss us, you know, it sounds like it just missed.
It's like millions of miles away.
Yeah, it's like it's not near our moon. It's not even close, you know, to hit our moon or anything like that. Yeah, I mean, the thing about asteroids is that we wouldn't see it because we're not necessarily looking out at everything. It would be hard for us to. It's very likely that we wouldn't even see it before it was too late. And if we did catch it, we could probably come up with a plan to derail it with some nukes or something like that to get it kind of off, you know, off orbit. If an asteroid hit our moon, that would fuck
crazy.
Us up too.
I was gonna say, what happens if the moon just destroys and what does that do to
the
environment,
the
cycles?
All the tides get fucked up. All kinds of crazy shit would happen. Of course, bits of the moon would fly into Earth.
But don't you think we'd evolve though, right? Without a moon, or it might cook up too much, or I don't know. Like, what does that do?
I don't know, man. But asteroid, we wouldn't see. There's a good chance we wouldn't see an asteroid coming until it was too late. And then
really?
You got to no, because we don't have like mass surveillance of all this. You know how hard it is to catch things that are coming until it's too late. Like, at some point we'd be like, oh shit, there it is.
Yeah,
but there's not much we can do.
Yeah, but if an asteroid hits Florida, how fucked am I?
Because they're
here?
Not like on fire all the time, right? Those are meteorites.
Are you saying like an asteroid like the size of the United States coming, or like bigger? Like,
oh how? Dude, an asteroid the size of definitely the size of a city, if that hit the Earth, that would be catastrophic worldwide. Absolutely. I mean, the immediate blast would destroy a lot of people, but then it would cause so much shit to fly up into the sky that it would cause like this permanent winter that would last for like 100 years.
What?
Yeah, because of all the stuff that flies up, so all the debris
block
and
all
dust
the sun.
And blocks out the sun. So this is what happened to the dinosaurs. Uh-huh. The asteroid came, killed a bunch of people, but then what killed, dinosaurs, but then what killed the rest of the dinosaurs was the fact that the earth cooled down and plants died and the plant eaters died and then, you know, just down the food chain, right? If it hits the ocean, it could cause catastrophic deaths in the ocean. So we're all connected. And again, the problem is that we wouldn't necessarily see one that's coming. So I don't know.
Shit. Yeah. So, that's the thing though. That's like a potential that could always happen, but it's like, do you really want to sweat about it and think about it?
Would
like,
you? Well, let me ask you guys this.
What are you going to do about it?
What do you think would happen if the governments saw an asteroid and they're basically like, there's nothing we could do?
Yeah.
Do you think they would tell us?
No, they would all get them out. No way. They would all occupy all the rockets. And
they're
get out.
Going to Mars. Yeah, that's why, you know.
They're flying. They're
Tesla
out.
And yeah. Elon Musk is like, let's figure a way to get the fuck out
they'd
of
like
here.
They like orbit Earth yeah. until the Earth like, heals and they come back.
He's like, but I'm bringing my favorite car.
Yeah.
Yeah.
God, but would you want to know? Would you want to know? Like if there was like 48 hours, like, okay, 48 hours, you're basically everyone's going to die. Would you want to know? Would you rather be kept in the dark?
I'd want to know. Because I feel like there's certain things that you could potentially do. Don't you think?
I kind of want to know and like have some like epic place where I just like watch it come at me. Yeah.
Oh, shit, like that? You are like that.
Come
guy.
For me!
I wonder how many people would...
Is that like an Armageddon scene?
Maybe. Yeah.
I wonder probably. How many people would instantly become spiritual and religious. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah, exactly.
You know, instantly.
Oh, everybody would.
Listen, I know everybody. I ignored you my whole life.
Right. Everybody
can you let me
would
in?
Be,
can you
sure.
let me in?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you'd almost be a fool not
I'll
to.
Believe whatever you want. Yeah. I'll believe whatever you want.
You'd probably have like half the world would be super like good to each other, religious, spiritual.
Oh,
the
totally.
Other half would be like, everybody fucking take drugs. You know what I mean?
Oh, it's just like you see like something happens, all of a sudden everybody becomes patriotic. Yeah,
exactly.
Just immediately. Yeah, exactly. Same thing. Oh,
so check this out. If you go to the App Store, you can get the Mind Pump Media app where you can search for specific topics among all of our episodes, like almost like 750 episodes or something like that. So if you want to, you know, listen to episodes on fat loss, muscle building, you know, strip sets, partial, you know, reps, forced reps, you want to learn about fats, carbs, protein, whatever. Type it in the search function. It'll pull up all the episodes where we cover that particular topic. And the best part is the app is free.
Thank you for listening to Mind Pump. If your goal is to build and shape your body, dramatically improve your health and energy, and maximize your overall performance, check out our discounted RGB Super Bundle at mindpumpmedia.com. The RGB Super Bundle includes MAPS Anabolic, MAPS Performance, and MAPS Aesthetic. 9 months of phased expert exercise programming designed by Sal, Adam, and Justin to systematically transform the way your body looks, feels, and performs. With detailed workout blueprints and over 200 videos, the RGB Super Bundle is like having Sal, Adam, and Justin as your own personal trainers, but at a fraction of the price. The RGB Super Bundle has a full 30-day money-back guarantee, and you can get it now plus other valuable free resources at mindpumpmedia.com. If you enjoy this show, please share the love by leaving us a 5-star rating and review on iTunes and by introducing Mind Pump to your friends and family. We thank you for your support, and until next time, this is Mind Pump.